maybe don't want to read so much numbers and all those other ones that might take a little bit more time to get through. But what comes to mind? Rules, regulations. Do this, don't do that. You can't do this, just one page. More specifically, one of the rules we think about, or list of rules, is probably the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make any graven images. Thou shalt not covet. Thou shalt not steal. Don't do this. Don't do that. And we number, and those are probably the most famous ones, the Ten Commandments. When we look at the law, it goes by several different names. If we look up, and we don't have to for the sake of time here in this opening portion, but the law is actually known by several different names. We know it in Numbers chapter 19, verse 2, the Bible defines it as the law. In Exodus chapter 34, and verse 28, it refers to it as the Ten Commandments. It's also been known as the Decalogue. In Hebrews chapter 9, verse 4, the law becomes known as the Tables of the Commandments. It's also referred to throughout scriptures as the Tables of Stone. When we look at the law, surprise, surprise, I'm sure we all know where it's been given to and to whom it was given. We know that it was given to Moses upon Mount Sinai. In Exodus chapter 31 and verse 18, Exodus 31 and 18, Exodus 31 and verse 18, I'll go ahead and read that. We find that the law didn't come by mortal man, but it came by God himself. In Exodus chapter 31 and verse 18, the Bible states, "And he, speaking of God, gave unto Moses, when he had made an end of communing with him upon Mount Sinai, two tables of testimony, tables of stone, written with the finger of God." So we know that the Ten Commandments, when they were written down, they weren't passed down by Moses went up on a mountain and heaved it down, thought for a little bit, and wrote, "This sounds good, this sounds good." But rather, God himself gave him the law. And he didn't just tell Moses, "Okay, be my secretary and write it down." But he said, God himself wrote down on the tables of stone with his own finger what the law was. So the law came directly through God himself. And when Moses descended from the mountain, he saw the Israelites worshiping the golden calf, and he broke the original tablets. We find that in Deuteronomy chapter 10 and verse 2. Deuteronomy 10, 2. Where the Bible states, "And I will write on the tables," okay, "and I will write on the tables the words that were in the first tables, which thou breakest, and thou shalt put them in the ark." So once again, we find that Moses broke when he came down worshiping the golden calf. He goes up again, and God says, "Okay, I will write them down again." So the Ten Commandments, or the law, which extends beyond the Ten Commandments, I think there's actually 318 when we break down, get down and study it out, laws that God gave to them. But God wrote them down on the tables of stone himself. And the Ten Commandments were later, or the law was later stored in the Ark of the Covenant. We found that in the passage which we just read. It was also confirmed in Hebrews 9, 4. So in the Ark of the Covenant, there was the pot of manna, Aaron's staff that budded originally, and the Ten Commandments. Later on, it would just be the Ten Commandments. The pot and the rod would be later taken out. The law is extremely important because it is a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. It points the way to Christ. So when we look at the law itself, it's not just a list of do's and don'ts, but it's revealing Christ to us, and it's also pointing us to him. So it's not meant to be a slap on the wrist or step on your toes and matter of send you in the corner to think about what you did, but it's rather to point you in the right direction so you can find resolve for the issue. In Galatians chapter 3 and verse 24, the Bible states, wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified through faith. So the law wasn't the means to the end, but rather it was to point us in the direction to go. To go to Jesus Christ to find resolve that we might be justified, or that we might be saved, not of our works, but through faith. See, when we look at the Old Testament, we talk about the Jews and the law. They tried and they tried and they tried to fulfill the law. They tried to fulfill it and make it good in their lives. They tried to do the law, but they failed every single time. Why did they fail every single time? Because when we look at the law, it's not something that you can do in the flesh. It's hard. It's tough. Doesn't matter how many times we try, we fail. The law can only be fulfilled through the spiritual aspect, through the guidance and the strength of the Holy Ghost. When we look at the Jews in the Old Testament, they didn't look to God to be their help to fulfill the law, but they tried to fulfill it through their flesh, through their own means. And they tried to fulfill something that was spiritual through something that was physical. Therefore, they failed every single time. And failure brings disappointment. Because the flesh is weak. If someone will please read Romans chapter 8 and verse 3. Romans 8 and verse 3. So the law was our schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. And Romans 8 and verse 3 states that we couldn't fulfill the law through the flesh. It took God sending his own son in the likeness of man to condemn the sin in the flesh. So the only way to overcome the law is through Jesus Christ. Because the flesh is weak. And if we jump back through to Galatians chapter 3, verse 24, the schoolmaster, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us through to Christ. And then catch the ending there, that we might be justified through faith. The only way that we are going to fulfill the law is through faith in Jesus Christ. If someone would please read Romans chapter 8, 2 through 5. Romans 8, 2 through 5. Do you still have that one? Romans 8. You want to go ahead and read that, please.
For the law of the Spirit, his wife in Christ Jesus, hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, and that was weak through the flesh, God sent his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. They that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit.
The only way to overcome the law is through faith in Jesus Christ. There is no other way to overcome the law. Now, when we look at the law, we know that there was a fulfillment. And there was an individual that was this fulfillment. We find that in Matthew chapter 5, verse 17. Matthew 5, 17. If someone will please go ahead and read that. Matthew 5, 17. So when we look at the coming of Christ, he didn't come to do away with the law, but he came to fulfill the law. What does that mean? It means that for those who don't know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, the law is still that schoolmaster that points them to Christ. Because before any of us can receive Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, we have to realize something. That we're a sinner and that we need help. If an individual never realizes that, there is nothing or no need of a Savior because there's nothing to save them from. They are perfect. But once the individual realizes that they have sinned in their life, that they are not perfect, and that they can't do anything in themselves, then they, at that point, they realize that they need a Savior. And how are they going to know that they're a Savior? The Bible states that the law is that schoolmaster that brings them and points them to Christ. For those of you that were in Sunday school, as we were going throughout our evangelism course, we listened to Ray Comfort 1 week. And what he does is he liked to go through the Ten Commandments. When people come up, well, even though they think they're fine, well, have you ever told a lie, even a small lie? Well, yeah, well, what does that make you? It makes you a liar. Well, have you ever stolen anything before? Even if it was somebody's piece of candy. Well, yeah, I might have stolen something before. Have you looked upon someone of the opposite sex to lust after them? Well, the Bible states that you're an adulterer. So by your own mouth, you're a lying, thieving adulterer. They have to realize that their need for Christ is there, that they are a sinner. They have to get lost first. So Christ didn't come to do away with the law, but fulfill the law. And Christ is the one that redeemed us from the curse of the law. We find that in Galatians chapter 3, verse 13. Galatians 3 and verse 13, where the Bible states, Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. So Christ took the punishment of the law that should be ours, because when you get down to it and you break down the law, what was the punishment for practically everything? Death. Stoning. It wasn't just being pushed outside the camp. It was a matter of being killed. The law brought death. The punishment for breaking the law was death. We talked about how the Israelites could not keep the law in the flesh. We cannot keep the law in the flesh. We can only keep the law because of our faith in Jesus Christ. And because of our faith in Jesus Christ, the work that he's done on the cross, he has taken the punishment for us and taken and redeemed us from the curse of the law. And it is only through his righteousness that the law has no effect on us. We find that in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 9. Philippians 3, 9, where the Bible states, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. So it's not of our own righteousness. It is because of Christ's righteousness that the law has no effect on us. If we get down to it and we begin studying the Word of God and we pull it apart, what does the Bible say concerning our righteousness? It is as filthy rags. It is good for nothing. And if we stand before God in our own righteousness, we're a ragged beggar who's a sinner. There's nothing covering us. Our rags are filthy. They are tarnished. They are dirty. When we are saved, then we put on the righteousness of Jesus Christ, which is perfect. It is blameless. It is without blemish. It is without spot. It is without wrinkle. It is whiter than snow. We find a perfect example of this back in the book, I think it is of Zechariah, where the high priest is standing before God on trial, and he has an accuser of the brethren. God cannot try that man because his righteousness is no longer his own. The high priest has put on the garment of Jesus Christ, and therefore he is clean. When we put on the garment of Jesus Christ, we no longer have our old righteousness, but we have the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And the only reason we have righteousness through Jesus Christ is because of our faith in the work that he's done and our faith in him alone. And because of that, we are redeemed from the law, and the law has no effect on us. Now, what is the law if we were to break down? We know what the Old Testament states that the law is. But what is the law according to the words of Jesus Christ? In Matthew chapter 19, and the pastors have already taught on this from the book of John, but Matthew 19, verses 16 through 22, the Bible states, "And behold, one came and said unto him, Good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? And he said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments. And he said unto him," which Jesus said, Jesus said, "Thou shalt do no murder, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness. Honor thy father and thy mother, and thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself." The young man saith unto him, "All these things have I kept from my youth up. What lack I?" Jesus said unto him, "If thou wilt be perfect, go and sell that thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me." But the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. So Jesus gave to him the law, basically, as we know, the Ten Commandments. If we go a little bit farther and study it out, we know the Word of God breaks down the law into less numbers. He actually breaks it down into two. God actually breaks down the Ten Commandments into two different commandments. They're found in Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 5. Deuteronomy 6, 5. If someone please read that. Someone else. And I'll go ahead and get Matthew 22, 36 and 40. Someone has Deuteronomy 6, 5. Thou shalt love the Lord with all thy heart and thy soul and thy might. In Matthew 22, 36 through 40, the Bible states, "Then one of them which was a lawyer asked him a question, tempting him, saying, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy might. This is the first and great commandment. And second is like unto it, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. One of these two commandments hang on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." So we go from having these, I think it's 318 laws, to it's broken down to two. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy might or thy mind. And thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. If we actually get down and study it, the law is broken down even simpler for us. In Galatians chapter 5 and verse 14, Galatians 5, 14, if someone will please find that one, and I'll find Romans chapter 13, 8 through 10. So the law is fulfilled in how many words? One. And he said, "Love thy neighbor as thyself." Romans 13, verse 8 through 10. If I get to the right chapter. "Owe no man anything but to love one another, for he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. For this, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not covet, and if there be any other commandment, it is briefly comprehended in the same, namely, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Love worketh no ill to his neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of the law. So when we get down to the law, there's many do's, there's many don'ts. Don't do this, don't do that. When we get down to it, the law is simply fulfilled in one word. Not all these do's, not all these don'ts, not even the big long phrases, thou shalt love the Lord with all thy heart, soul, and mind, love thy neighbor as thyself, but in one word. And that is love. If we look at those two phrases that the law was broken down into, love, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, and mind, love thy neighbor as thyself, the key word in both of those phrases is love. The law, even though we make it so complicated, is simply fulfilled through one word, and that is the word love. And that's what it all comes down to. And when we look at the law itself, Christ did not come to do away with the law, but to fulfill the law. And what's marked Christ coming to fulfill the law? Love. For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. When we look throughout the Word of God, including the Old Testament, we know that the Son of God did not come for any other reason but to seek and to save that which is lost. And he did that, why? One word, love. That is the fulfillment of the law. If we are going to fulfill the law in our own lives, it's not a matter of trying to do all the do's, all the don'ts, and avoid them, but it's a matter of making sure that we do one thing. That is love. And to do that is not always easy. It really isn't. We've all worked customer service before. We've all worked with people. And there are days that I come home and I tell Sister Beth that when the rapture happens, I want the mansion on the farthest wall at the highest point. I want it wrapped in bug zap wire. I just want to be left alone for a while. But when it gets down to it, the law is not that. It's not avoiding people. But it is love. Love thy neighbor as thyself. If we had that mentality, it'd be a world of a difference. Maybe in our own lives, how we respond to people. If we come down to it, we just need more of the love of God. The closer we get to God, the more love we're going to have. We can always do with more love. Because we need to treat people how we want to be treated. If we don't, why are they going to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior? What benefit are they going to see in Christianity? Are they going to see God? Or are they going to see us? Are they going to see a religion? No. When we look at throughout the Word of God, that is God. God is love. He that loveth not knoweth not God, because God is love. And in love is the law fulfilled. Anybody have any thoughts, any questions, anything they want to add at this point in time? Sometimes we make things so difficult. Sometimes we overcomplicate things. But I love when the Word of God interprets itself, how it explains itself. When we dig and we dive and we pull it apart, how it truly explains itself. It's not a book just written by man, but it was a book written by God. And God has all the nuggets that we need to know right now on this earth in there. It's just a matter of seeking and finding. Why don't we just stand in front of this place? And Brother Doug, would you dismiss us in prayer?
Good Father, so thankful, God. Word for your word. Just, Lord, we just pray, Lord God, to just read these words, mean something.